Pioneer Square is what I like the most about Seattle. Just enjoy walking around and looking at everything down there.
The thing I like about Seattle is to go downtown, looking at different people.
Well, I like the population of the city very, very much.
The main reason I like Seattle is it's consistently rainy weather. When it turns nice, everybody really enjoys it and appreciates it.
If he just wants to go out and kind of soak up what Seattle has to offer, I think that you can find a real good day.
The beauty I see in Seattle is the diversity. The fact that you can walk along a street, you can see an old mansion, Victorian, Baroque, something, a style that never really existed, somebody just created it. And right next door you can see the most modern, up-to-date apartment house. You walk a little farther, you have an old lot, nothing's in it, junk and corruption, congestion that you can walk into. Congestion that you can see, diversity, chaos happening, but it's all wonderful. It's helping Seattle move, and it's beautiful.
And I have been deluged by opinions, rendered by opinion polls, and cited in, you know, in newspapers and magazines. Hundreds and hundreds, perhaps thousands. And never once have I officially been asked my opinion on anything.
The stores downtown are probably more elegant and have more things in them than just regular little suburban stores because they cater to more people in their area. But the downtown stores are beautifully decorated and they have a lot of nice things and they have a lot of nice products. And if you would want to spend an afternoon downtown, you could go to many interesting places to eat or to have lunch, and you could sort of take part in the hustle and bustle that's going on, like during the holidays. There are all sorts of people bustling around. It sort of gives you a feeling of wanting to kind of be a part of a cosmopolitan area. Otherwise, you could just live in Puyallup.
Somebody said recently that one reason we should keep a place like the Armory or the Pike Street Market is it's like having a wise old man around to tell children things about how the past was. It's things they can't find on television. It's true, you know. There are real things, and then there are imaginary things, and we can give direction to everything. You know, it just depends on what you want.
Everyone finds something special about Seattle, but the people in the city are the key ingredient. Since people are a city's greatest asset, some say that what Seattle needs is a heart transplant, something to bring back the city dwellers. When a city fails to offer a humane environment, a mass exodus begins. The quality of urban life can be measured in part by how willing people are to spend their leisure time within the city. What would it take to make you give up freeway driving? What if the distance from your front door to your office was a quiet walk down a boulevard of trees? Next to people, trees are the best friends Seattle has. The lure of suburban trees led people out of Seattle. Maybe those same trees might lead the move back. Consider how one tiny rooftop garden can brighten the lives of 400 apartment dwellers. people are always more willing to live where they can enjoy a bit of nature. Unfortunately, Seattle is without a major downtown park. Imagine the beauty and meaning of a green belt where it's needed most, in the Denny Regrade. This section of the city, now overrun with parking lots and one and two-story buildings, is ready for a change. There's room for a 53-acre park, bounded by 5th Avenue, 2nd Avenue, and Lenora. A space to complement the noise and activity of the city. Adjacent to the park on the west, where the topography changes, high-density apartments would also have the dramatic western view. This new park would allow you to stroll through nature from the heart of downtown business to the Seattle Center or along one of several connecting avenues. The trade makes sense. Urban blight for a humane environment. Grass for asphalt. Trees for telephone poles. We must act now to have this park. You can do your part. Take a tree to lunch next week.
We're going to have change, and we're going to have process, and we should start thinking in terms of how to direct it and how to channel it so that we get an environment that's not hostile to ourselves.
Probably one of the most interesting aspects about going to downtown Seattle is perhaps not actually purchasing anything, but just to sort of observe the interaction that takes place between human beings, sales clerks, and the mass of humanity who sort of strolls through the foyer of Frederick and Nelson's or the public market. We see time salesmen on corners, weazened up old men and young boys. You see people who are from all sorts of various cross-sections of Seattle interacting and taking part in a sort of great cosmopolitan atmosphere.
Follow the flow of people and you find the unique internal crossroads of Seattle, where daily visitors and shoppers by the thousands enter and exit the central business area. Every great city has its epicenter, a baseline to match its skyline. For New York, it's Rockefeller Center. For San Francisco, it's Union Square. And for Seattle, the paths converge on Westlake Mall. A drugstore marks the spot. How often do you hear someone say, "Let's go visit Westlake Mall"? Brave 23 traffic lights and take a walk around it. Then join the 5,000 commuters a day who use the narrow sidewalk for a loading platform. A city center without a focus, only a potential. Free the space. Relocate a few businesses from the center to the sides, and within the intersection could grow a new heart for Seattle. A perfect place to meet a friend or spend a day. Lake Union shines at night. One of those great things about Seattle. A rare lake that combines business with pleasure. Almost everything that floats. And some things that don't. The problem with Lake Union is getting near it, unless you own your own dock. There are city street ends, all blocked. Land in limbo. Not one public park that allows you to sit near the water. The spectacular natural axis of the lake is defined by a cement plant and a gas works. A few more years of purely industrial development and the best view of the lake will be from a plane at 5,000 feet. In 1907, the lake was full size. 7 miles of shoreline and water you could swim or fish. Then the fill began, all legal. Each dock owner has the option of filling in the lake out to his last pier. Today, the lake is only 75% of its original area. If the shrink continues and all the legal fill is again completed, Union Pond will then be one half the size it was in 1907. Even the ducks are giving up. the lake may still have a future. Careful zoning and public concern would halt the shrink and still preserve a balanced use of the water. The gasworks at the north end could become the lake's first public park. Tree-lined avenues would form a necklace of green with an excellent view of every passing boat. Who knows? It might seem like Lake Union belonged to all of us. Pioneer Square is one of Seattle's greats, a dying great. Buildings without people are without a function. A new concern is needed to end the decay. Seattle had its beginnings in the square, and many important historical structures still stand, but not for long. Many have already been demolished. Other cities have had to rescue their heritage. San Francisco did it with Ghirardelli Square and a self-supporting program of restoration. Not piecemeal remodeling, but a total design concept. If the original spirit of Pioneer Square is to be regained, we have to bring the people back. Restaurants, night spots, shops, offices, and apartments would ensure round-the-clock life for this area. Rebirth of the square will require new space for new people. The triangular parking lot, which destroys the unity of the square, can be relocated. And in its place, a pedestrian park extending to join 4 acres of connected trees, walks, benches, fountains, and flowers. A link between the City Hall complex and the waterfront. Unreasonable? More reasonable than trading history for a place to park cars. Almost every civilized city in Western Europe has a waterfront dedicated to its inhabitants. Seattle dedicated Elliott Bay to 8 lanes of overhead freeway, a concrete barricade between the people and the water. Strange that a city with 90 miles of waterfront would turn its back on one of the world's great seaports. Seattle seems more adapted to cars than to people.
Country is becoming Los Angelized, which is probably the most terrible fate you can think of. I don't really know anything good to say about it anymore. You couldn't say, if you go downtown, you couldn't say where you were if you didn't know. I just liked Seattle the way it was, and I still like certain things about it. Physically, it still is a beautiful city in many ways. That's what it comes down to, is that Seattle, possibly less than other cities, has less a sense of experiencing things. It doesn't matter. The conservationists, the people who want to keep the old, want to keep it as something to look at. They don't want to keep it as part of a rhythm of life and an experience of life. It's just part of the system of America, because you can't cure it in one place and not everywhere else. Americans today live to be tourists. That's what they train their kids to be more than anything else, to be tourists in life. Take a tour through the countries of the world, through the states of the Union. Take a tour through the religions or the races of the world. But above all, don't live, you know. Don't commit yourself or your guts or your blood to living.